same percentage turnout. But, you know, that means somewhere around 100,000 people, maybe more, didn't vote for president in San Diego County. And Bernie Sanders lost by, what did Mr. Let's say, about 16,000 votes. So I'm thinking a lot of those people who didn't vote for president might have actually voted if they had the chance, might have voted for Bernie Sanders, might have wanted to vote for Bernie Sanders, or maybe did vote for Bernie Sanders. Maybe run him in, or here's another thing that happened, as Ray mentioned. I don't know if this happened on the crossover ballots. This is another issue, though. There were people who voted for Bernie Sanders who, for reasons that have yet to be determined, their votes were whited out. We have heard various explanations from Michael Vu. The only explanation we have not heard from Michael Vu was, we didn't do it. So the ROV has conceded that they have whited out votes. One explanation was, oh, well, it's okay, because those were Republicans voting on Democratic ballots. So they won't give NPP voters the right ballots, but they'll give Republicans the wrong ballots. Let's see. Another one was, oh, those were overvotes. So some people voted twice, so we just decided who they really wanted to vote for. These are things that Michael Vu has actually written down, okay? Another one was that they were just simply crossing out the wrong stuff. Like if they voted on a Democratic ballot, they voted for like Central Committee, they were just weighing out that stuff. But I'm not sure why they were weighing out Bernie Sanders votes in particular. Now, how can we stop that? Well, I mean, that seems like a problem, please God, that is unique to San Diego County. How can we stop that kind of behavior? Well,
jail.
I mean, again, I think one of the problems is we need to unseat Michael Vu. So they ran out of ballots in Mendocino County?
Yeah, so about five precincts, starting after about 1 o'clock, they started sending out Xerox copies of ballots instead of actual ballots, and those all went into the provisional.
Okay, that's ridiculous.
Right?
Yeah, I mean, this is a problem that should be taken care of before Election Day.
They had enough ballots. They had many, many. They showed us a mountain of extra ballots, and we were like, so why were you sending Xerox copies saying you were out of ballots and you have all these ballots? And they said, oh, they had to set those aside for the remakes that they anticipated, because they had to remake the provisional ballots. You know, they remake them. They remake them. And not only that, but they were wiping out, and the remake ballots, many of them had already been opened, slit open by the time we finally got to and observe them being processed.
So what were they using the whiteout for? This is new.
We asked about that. I don't know if we got any good answers. I do remember one excuse was if they had gone to vote in the wrong precinct, and so there was somebody on that ballot that wouldn't have been the correct precinct, then it was not a legitimate vote, so they would therefore wipe it out.
But okay, so this trend is contagious, it seems.
There's boxes in the clerk's office in Mendocino County of ballots that have whiteouts and all kinds of other stuff going on, and I don't know how we can get the right to have them recounted.
Yeah, legally, they're only allowed to do it if they're corrected. Like usually it means a mangled ballot, but thousands and thousands of these emerged in Ohio, and now it appears that Michael Vu's changed states, so the same practice is migrated with it.
Well, you know, the Registrar's community is a small community. I mean, I wonder if they've gotten together and started talking. I know they have retreats.
That's the interesting thing. So Sue Ramishak, who's the head registrar, Nobody ever runs against her. She, her sponsor, her highest sponsor on her list is the sheriff's department. And who did she say she was going to call? She told me she was going to have me removed by the sheriff. And I haven't done anything. I asked somebody in a public hallway if they would notice that we can't see anything.
Okay, so she's an elected official running a corrupt, possibly registrar's office. So the remedy is what? I mean, you can't vote her out of office, right?
So,
I mean, let's suppose somebody did vote against her. What do you suppose would happen?
Yeah, I know. I wonder about that. And the sheriff is also a registered, you know, I mean, an elected official. But so she's telling us, literally, quote, "I don't give a rat's ass about this election," unquote, not answering our questions and being hostile toward us, threatening to call the sheriff. And in the meantime, we come to find out that she is the vice president of this organization that
the registrar here. Yes. And we followed up by going to a Board of Supervisors meeting in which she let drop the information that she is the vice president of the California Association of Registrars of Voters.
Well, I mean,
clerks and registrars of voters.
You know, maybe somebody that's watching this live stream can help me and Bill, you know, form a coalition of attorneys that can help fight back against this sort of monstrosity. You know, this is becoming a really serious problem. I mean, you don't need 58 corrupt registrars. If you have 5 or 6 corrupt registrars in a state, that can be enough to throw off this entire state. Yeah.
Bill, I'm going to Don, and then over here, Don.
It's not that this is becoming a problem. This has been a problem for a long time. And, you know, as Bob indicated, the registrars of voters in each county are running their own fiefdoms. So you may have some regulations coming down from the Secretary of State, but how they're interpreted and how they're carried out in each individual county is totally subject to the whims of the registrar voters in that county. So for those of you who are new to this scenario, this is not news for those of us who have been fighting this battle for at least 12 years. And so what we really need, aside from a coalition of attorneys who will really focus in, you know, like a laser beam on what is happening in the state of California, the purpose of this conference is really to build a statewide movement that says we're not going to put up with this anymore.
Right.
And that ultimately, we want the Secretary of State to actually be somebody who is A, nonpartisan, and B, who puts forward a set of laws. Well, the laws have to be passed by the legislature, but the Secretary of State can put forth regulations whereby we have uniformity across 58 counties. But as the slogan goes, eternal vigilance is the price of liberty. So we have to be watching the elections.
Right.
We have to be watching the election officials. And we truly have to build an election integrity movement. Now, many people in the United States know that there are problems with elections. And oh my God, the mainstream media has suddenly discovered that you can hack the elections. Well, shocking. Some of us have been screaming about that for 12 and 16 years. So that's the enormity, but this is how we build a movement, by first educating those of us who already experienced it firsthand, who are either observers or activists or working in the polls. And let me just say a quick word about people who work on election day in the poll, in the precincts. The variability in their level of training and competence is enormous. So one of the things we can do, and again, one of the purposes of this conference, is to encourage a whole bunch of people to become poll workers on election day who are young, who can actually lift the screen, the optical scanning machines, etc., and who have the energy to keep track of what is going on. and to challenge what is going on. And yes, what Bill said earlier, we must escalate this effort to civil disobedience if necessary.
Some guy in California who only voted for Bernie Sanders, and they ran his car through the machine like 5 times, and each time it spit it out saying there was no vote, even though it was like clearly marked. They finally ran it through. They bypassed the thing that would kick it back, and then I was looking online for because I'm a instant runoff voting, ranked choice voting advocate. And I've lived in St. Croix for a short time, and somehow I ended up on their website, and they have a machine that you go on the computer on a touch screen, you type in all the people you want, you can rank choice and all that. It prints out a ballot that then you can look at and verify, and you walk over to a reader and it reads your ballot. So there's no issues with overvoting, voting for the wrong people,
right,
all that stuff, and it allows ranked choice
voting. Just 2 questions. There's 90,000 ballots that have never been counted in Ohio. Over calibration, they all come primarily from the Toledo and the inner city area. The technicians working for Diebold didn't calibrate the machine right, so they were spit out. Also, other ones that were similar, the wrong markers were assigned, so they weren't counted. It was a horrendous accident that occurred only in the inner city. And of course, your system, Ethan Gibbs, came up with that system in 2004. You can read about it at motherjones.com under my name. Nathan Gibbs said, look, Diebold is making machines. They make ATMs and they have receipts. But their machines don't have any receipts. There's no way to audit them. So he came up with the system that you designed. Tragically, 1 week after I wrote about him in the Columbus Free Press and on Mother Jones, he was hit by an 18-wheeler on the expressway and killed. He's also the source that said a lot of this stuff really was used overseas to rig elections in the third world, and that he felt that the technology had come out of the CIA and was being brought back to the USA. So Ethan Gibbs, I consider a martyr of this movement. He was the first major whistleblower who died 1 week after MotherJones.com published an article as him as the spoken source.
And I want to add something to that. Okay.
I
have to
ask another question.
I just want to say, and he was on his way to the Georgia legislature to show this machine. And it was a direct threat to Diebold.
Wow.
It was.
What's his name again?
Ethan Gibbs.
Ethan Gibbs?
Ethan.
And his family.
Like Ethan without an S.
His family collapsed in pain. It was an 18-wheeler, and there was no way that they couldn't figure out, just like the China syndrome, you know, why it, he died. Karen Silver.
My question is a little bit changing the subject, not that that's not really, really important subject, which is to sort of get back to the notion of the enormity of California and the different registrars of voters. I've heard that in Humboldt County, there is a actual decent registrar of voters that allowed open source voting system to be used there to count the votes. If that's one of the counties that Bernie Sanders did the best in that county, whether that's a coincidence or not is a different topic. But I'm wondering if it's true that a lot of the registrars of voters are corrupt, or some of them are, we don't know how many, it might be the way in is to find one that we know is honest and to sort of go in that way rather than to try to find the one that's honest and assume that most are honest and there's only a few corrupt ones. I just wonder if anybody had approached the registrar voters in Humboldt County about this.
I should speak to
them. Lori actually is the one who put up the money and convinced them to go with open source.
I decided that in addition to going out, looking at things in the undercover world and trying to stop corruption, and I decided to award a prize to a registrar of excellence. And Carolyn Serge of Humboldt County and Mitch Trachtenberg, and I know Kevin Collins is here, and he's going to talk from Humboldt. Kevin approached Carolyn Cernich about creating a more transparent system. And Carolyn Cernich, now retired, really took that on and allowed Mitch Trachtenberg to design an open source software to count the votes. And there was tremendous appreciation. Carolyn Cernich, an elected registrar, would be stopped on the streets by people thanking her so deeply for how she was helping to create transparency and integrity. And her life was just so happy, you know, and so supported by the people. And so I decided to award several awards. One was to Kevin Collins there, and also Carolyn Cernich and Mitch Trachtenberg, and I think that was the three. And to really show up a hero, a heroine, actually. And then Carl Carter, who isn't here, I guess, and I tried to promote this, and we tried to create a pilot project in Santa Clara County with the registrar there that was Diebold, and he was kind of dissatisfied with it, but he didn't go with it. And then also I tried to convince Elaine Genold of Marin County, and she wouldn't hear of it. So it is a kind of a tough fight, but I think we must celebrate our heroines and heroes as well as go after the scumbags, you know. And I hope that there will be some. Is it possible to do a recall of Michael Vu, Bill?
Or that's a good question. I don't think it is. He's not an elected official.
I can actually give you just a scotch of information.
One last question. I apologize. I was an election integrity activist in San Diego County prior to Michael Vu coming to San Diego County. I was working with Mimi Kennedy against the prior registrar. And so basically what happened when Michael Vu had to resign in disgrace in Ohio, the San Diego County Board of Supervisors, which hires the registrar voters in San Diego County, scooped him up just like that. Okay, so they loved what he did in Ohio, and they're very, very conservative, or were, Board of Supervisors down there, and they just grabbed him up right away. And so since he is appointed, you have to re-elect, you have to change, elect new supervisors. Good luck with that, with Michael Vu as the registrar.
Wow. Hey, last question that I'm going to ask the panel to wrap up, because so many comments came in. Give them a chance to send two words. Go ahead, last question.
Okay, so
I just wanted to comment on this discussion, just briefly.
Do you want this?
Sure.
Introduce yourselves.
I appreciated your comments, Laurie, and
Kevin Collins.
Yeah, I'm with Transparency Project, and I worked with Carolyn since 2003. And I got to say one thing: we've got to watch out as an integrity movement. At the same time that Carolyn kept us on a paper ballot when her election manager was suggesting that we switch to all electronic touchscreens in 2003, and some of us that worked with her realized that she got it, there was still an element within our group up there, people that normally I would feel like, you know, were brothers, who portrayed her as a villain because she did not instantly drop the system that she had to go right away to vote in the precincts and vote in the precincts. And they demanded that she resign and that kind of thing. And I don't think it's fair to assume that all registrars are corrupt. I think that those of us that worked with her realized that she was really trying to get it together. And I think it proved out in time. But there is a danger there. I mean, I don't doubt Vu and the gal down in LA and even Dean Logan, who came from Washington, where Beth Harris can tell you stories about one of the close elections there, have different histories. But you have to determine, look beyond our worst paranoia sometimes and give them some slack and see if they will start working with us. And in Carolyn's case, it was well worth it, and we've been very fortunate that way.
Well, one last question.
Hi, my name is Violeta, and I did some supervising of the ballot count observers in San Francisco, and I experienced a lot of energy. I had a lot of help from a lot of young people, students from San Francisco State University, people that were willing to jump on board after work and go and do supervision. And I feel like now, after Bernie has lost, that all that energy is gone. And this is what everybody here feels. It's been like a breathing session most of today from that's how I perceived it. And I just want to go back to what Don was saying a little bit earlier about getting people to get involved again and be on top of this elections, the way the vote is count, and what you were saying a little earlier about how do we supervise or how do we get people like Michael Root not to do what they are doing. And I don't know, I was hoping that somebody here in this gathering would have some ideas. How do we get people to be enthusiastic again? How do we get people to put forth that energy? Because it's, you know, everything that happened, and right now it's what are we going to do next? That is the big question. So what do I say to the people in my Facebook group that I have about 100 people that were very involved, and how do I get them to be involved again in the next coming election? And how do we get to change things? I see so many people that have so many ideas, but I feel like we're not really putting them together. Everybody is here and wants to share, but how do we create a forum in which all these ideas come on the table, and maybe how do we get the ball rolling again? That's my big question.
I'll leave it up to the panel.
We have the test too. So.
Go ahead. Some comments.
Yeah, this is sort of, I wanted to comment this with from a sort of bird's eye perspective. I feel like, yeah. So like many people here have mentioned today, we need to build a movement. So this, you know, November election, you know, as I said earlier, it was lost on June 7th, but we can do whatever we can to protect the down ballot candidates and votes, because they matter. It will affect our everyday lives on a very direct level. And in terms of what Bernie said one Thursday back in June, it was not a concession speech as widely expected by Hillary people. Instead, it was a call for an all-out revolution. He started talking about that this is not a matter of sitting on the couch. People die. This is real work where we have to get out into the streets and fight for our rights. So, okay, I might be hit by an 18-wheeler after I say this and it's streamed somewhere. But I think we need a multi-pronged approach. We need to continue working on the movement. We need to, you know, this group here, there are many veterans among you. I'm totally new to this. And you know, you could build from this core and build a powerful movement through, but I think it needs to be based on education. We need to really focus on education because it's shameful how little people know out there. I mean, people don't know the difference between AIP and MPP. I know it's not sexy at all. I mean, Lee Kamp can make it sexy, but that's about it. I have a crush on him. Women, come on. Men, women, everybody has a crush on him. Everybody who's been working on election protection. Because literally, and I told him this in Philly, like he kept me alive and sane through this horrific primary. If it weren't for his humor, I don't know how I would have survived. So maybe we can make Lee our leader to help us with humor, to wade through these, as Bill likes to call it, bean counting, this totally unsexy business of figuring out the ballots and the counties and the precincts and the blah and the, yeah, so, but the specifics that I think some people have voiced today is, you know, we need to fight for standardization of these poll worker training manuals and procedures in California. We can't have these 58 fiefdoms, no way, no how, that on page 47 in Santa Clara County poll worker training manual can say in bold italicized letters, do not inform MPP voters of their choices. I mean, that's insane. That should be criminal. On that note, we need to really change. So this is what I would get. If you hear that I committed suicide, it will be because of what I'm going to say now. We need to declare an all-out war on mainstream media with every iota of our being. The media cannot call elections before they were held, let alone, I mean, before they were certified, let alone before they were held. So, I would just like to close on, we can empower ourselves. We know, Bernie showed us that we have the power. People have the power. If we stick together, if we don't fall for all these trolls online who are not trying to divide Bernie and Jill people because they're terrified. They're absolutely terrified of Jill because they know that a lot of votes are going from Bernie to Jill. And there's just amazing level of subterfuge on social media, which is kind of, I feel like this is where the trenches of this revolution have been in the social media. We've been fighting trench warfare for months, for over a year. And somebody mentioned, yeah, attorneys need help. I just want to mention that we need a revolutionary geek squad because our computers have been literally attacked, blown up. We need constantly changing our computers and phones and whatnot. We need help, cyber protection for lawyers. For election integrity.
I just wanted to say for clarification, I don't think all registrars are corrupt. I don't think they all need to be corrupt, though, to throw off an entire election. But also, at some point, intent doesn't matter. How well they do the job is what matters, okay? So whether you're corrupt or just incompetent, or, you know, I mean, some people are doing good jobs, job. What matters is they work for us, the people, all right? Our votes matter. I believe all that stuff that I learned in second grade, but our votes matter, okay? I still want to believe that. And so I really want people to still continue to get out there and observe the vote count. And it is kind of nerdy, you know? But still go to the polls on election day and watch how many provisional ballots there are now and watch the votes be
nothing will drive the registrar more nuts. But think about this. People do a better job when they're being watched. All right? And I think that one of the reasons they didn't want to be watched is because some people maybe aren't so good at their jobs. But, you know, whatever. Even if they mean well, and they're nice people, and they're just sloppy, we need to hold them accountable for what they're doing. They work for us, and they earn pretty decent money. They work for we the people. All right?
All right, we're gonna have to move on, but I agree on Lee Kamp only because I was on his show this week. Lori Grace arranged that, actually. Without my knowledge, she called up Lee Kamp, who's run some live streaming footage from some event, and I get a call from Lori, I booked you on Lee Kamp. So I flew in on Monday and played on Thursday. But with that in mind, I think we have a message here.
It's actually just a clip.
A clip? Okay.
I would love to take all the credit for finding out the details of this stolen election. Alas, it wasn't me. It was Election Justice USA, a national nonpartisan team of seasoned election integrity experts, attorneys, statisticians, and journalists, all of whom have the nerve to not be me. They put out a 100-page, it's a 100-page, extensively researched report on how the primary election was not legit. Multiple reports have shown that Hillary did much better in areas with provably hackable voting machines. And Alabama is a perfect case study. They use two kinds of voting machines to count their ballots there. One kind is hackable, and one is largely not. Three of their biggest counties, Jefferson, Mobile, and Montgomery, use the hack-friendly voting machines. According to Election Justice USA, Clinton won by 64% in Jefferson, 66% in Mobile, and a stunning 73% in Montgomery. However, in Madison, another large county with similar demographics, they do not use the hackable machines. And Clinton only won by 38%, 30 points lower than areas with hackable machines. That's a massive difference. That's like the difference between being a clown hired for a children's birthday party and being a clown that just showed up at a children's birthday party. That's terrifying. And we see this in state after state. And the exit polls were way off for many of the Democratic primaries. But on the Republican side, they were almost perfect. As Election Justice USA put it, this is remarkable. As the exit polls for both parties were conducted on the same day, in the same precincts, with the same interviewers, and used the same methodology.
That's it.
All right, Lee Kamp. And again, before I call on the last speaker, I was on the show because I mentioned it, suing Edison Research, and again, Lori Grace, paid for that lawsuit, as she did in 2012. In 2012, we sued. Some of you may recall this, we had two suits on the same day. I went into federal court, and some of you know Mickey Donahoe. I know a good friend of John's, right? We had an expert witness, 37 years with the NSA, who's come over to the side of light and truth. Does great work. They wouldn't recognize him as an expert witness. They had put secret custom patches in 41 counties, experimental patches, which under law are only allowed in one precinct. They had wired up the whole state with ES&S, and we went into state court after we got thrown out of federal court, and in state court, they said, let's leave this case over, open, and look at the numbers at the end. And then you recall, Washington Spectator's written about this, Karl Rove completely melts down as he begs Fox News please wait till all the numbers are in. But it was, they weren't going to flip the secret switch that day. So I appreciate Lori has put up the money. And I think that leads us to do something you need to do in California. It really looks like there's going to be a movement to reform this state. I can tell by the intensity in the voices of people, you're at that point where it's not going to go on much further. You have the attorneys here. You have some funding. Go forward, sue, occupy the polls, get rid of the voos, and do whatever you need to do to get rid of their voodoo. We have Nick Kuwata here with the Asian Law Alliance. He'll be the last speaker. And you had a quick comment?
Yeah, sending us out there on that note, should we be organizing a civil disobedience training session?
I think so. And bring your yellow tape. It's really good for the mainstream media. They understand it. And bring some chalk. Chalk the outline of what those machines look like that were involved in the grand theft. How's it going, Ken?
Good. Hi, everybody. How are you doing? So, my name's Nick. I'm with the Asian Law Alliance. It's really great to see all the energy in the room. I mean, I think one of the things that I see in Santa Clara County is a lot of dismissal of what this next election brings, what politics in general brings. You know, I work with a lot of young people, and I go to the campuses, and you have to almost like pry them into civic engagement, and I think that's a shame. That's what we need less of. So it's really great to be here today to talk to you really briefly about basically language access and some of the trials and tribulations that we've seen here in the minority communities in California. And coming from Santa Clara County, we have quite a few communities. I mean, we were talking about a very strong Vietnamese community, very strong Chinese community, very strong Filipino community. And, you know, it's risen to the level they actually afforded certain federal protections. So I'm just here today to tell you a little about what I know. I'm really honored to be here, really excited to talk to you a little bit more about what we see. Now, at Asian Law Alliance, we're a nonprofit law firm. We started actually in 1975, and we're called Asian Law Alliance. For better or for worse, because we were started by a group of Asian law students in the area. And they saw, at the time in 75, there weren't a lot of agencies particularized for minority communities. So we came together, my boss came together with a bunch of other law students to really start affecting change in those communities, start overcoming these things like the model minority myth that we see, you know, still prevalent to this day. Can we go back to the other slide? Sorry about that. I'm not going to get there. We provide services in English, Tagalog, Spanish, Korean, Vietnamese, Chinese, and more. You know, we want to be able to be in the community to talk to people at the level that they feel comfortable to talk to us. And we give free services in housing, immigration, public benefits, domestic violence, and finally now civic engagement, starting with this election. So I think the best question for all of you is, why should we care? Why should America care that minority communities are not voting? And well, for the Asian community anyway, looking at data collected by the Center for American Progress, the AAPI data, we are the fastest growing population in the United States. In fact, the number of Asian American voters in the last decade is nearly doubled from more than 2 million voters in 2000 to 3.9 million voters in 2012. If you look at the numbers, kind of extrapolate out forwards, we're looking at about 5% of the voters nationally by 2025 and 10% by 2044. If we all come out to vote, we've been kind of rah-rahing ourselves to call ourselves the margin victory. So, we saw it in the last election. We saw Latino Hispanic voters, Black American voters coming out to vote. It really made a difference at the local level. We're hoping to see more of that in the future because as we see us moving forward, you know, California is right now an outlier. We see us as a community of contrast that we're not seeing in other places in the United States, but that's going to change very, very soon. And I think if we continue to ignore those communities, I think we're going to see basically a fallout of the system where people aren't
being engaged, they're not being heard, and they're going to go on living without a government that can truly support them. And what good is this government if we don't have one that listens to us? So, you know, I think that's something that I hopefully resonates with all of us, that this is the future, and that we need to start embracing it now. Furthermore, you know, Asian Americans have notoriously been known as a Democratic-only population, but actually the large majority of us are undecided voters. And I can tell you, a lot of the major parties have done very little to cater to or even listen to those minority communities, okay? So, moving on, are we looking at possibly being ignored? Maybe that's true. You know, they did a study with Asian American young adults, and they were the least likely to receive election-related voter contact. Yet, we're still the most excited about the election. We went from a 37% voter turnout to a 63% voter turnout on our own. No one was there, no one was. Thank you. And I think that, you know, we heard from this woman a little earlier about where is that energy going? It's there. We need to harvest it. We need to keep moving forward with it because it's just going to die on its own. We need your energy. We need your spirit to move those people forward, to tell them that this election still matters. You know, I know a lot of us here in the room were very heartbroken when Bernie Sanders was dropped out of the race, but remember, there's still local election ballot measures on the ballot that need addressing, right? Thank you. So, I mean, at least here in Santa Clara County, we're looking at you know, things as important as affordable housing and Measure A, mass transit and BART moving down into San Jose and the Measure B. You know, these are things that I feel like a lot of people are ignoring because, you know, they only are looking at the presidential campaign and they are not looking at everything else that's on the ballot. This is going to be a landmark election. We have, I think it's over 20 now measures on our ballot. And then isn't that it now? I mean, it's unbelievable. And I think that the difficulty is when we talk about minority communities, we're then also looking at another layer. We're looking at things like language barrier. We're looking at cultural differences, right? How do we overcome those things? I'm hopefully going to give you a few ideas on how we can overcome those today. But anyway, I wanted to give you a few more statistics because I'm a stat man. But only 1 in 3 Asian American registered voters were reported being contacted by Democrats, and only 7% of those regarded those contacts being a great deal. Furthermore, you know, 24% of voters reported being contacted by the Republicans, and only 5% said their contact was a great deal. I mean, we're looking less than a quarter for both sides, and this is, I think, an atrocity because, I mean, I think the main reason we get civically engaged is because we can affect change. And if you're from a community that doesn't see that change, what is your spark? What is your desire to go out and then do that? You know, I talk to a lot of people who've been here in the country for a long time. You know, my family's now 4th, 5th generation family here in the United States, and we love being here in the United States, and we take part in the system. But there are new immigrants who have come to this country, to this state, and they don't even know who their own governor is. And it's because they're so concerned about politics abroad. Because they're not engaged, because they don't feel like it's important here in the United States. They're clearly political, but they're not political with the politics that matter, politics here in the United States. And that's what we need to change, okay? You know, I think possibly one of the major reasons why we're possibly ignored is because a lot of politicians see us as a divided community. You know, when you're looking at other communities like the Latino Hispanic community, you can see issues that bring them together. But you're not seeing that with the Asian American community. And I'm here today to tell you that's all a lie. That's not true at all. In fact, a study by the same group of people showed that we were strongly supportive of policies that address growing income inequalities. We're obviously major supporters of affirmative action and gun control. So I think there are issues that thread our communities together. I mean, granted, some of us are much more conservative than others. Some of the grounds you're not going to find any commonality within the Asian community. It's a very broad community. But I do feel like continual ignorance, you know, continual like pushing past basically us as a population is a bad idea. And we've seen this go on for too long. Okay, can we move to the next slide? Oh, perfect, thank you. So I think then, is it just the politician's fault? Well, no. A lot of it has to do with the community. My work with Asian Wallands is to help energize the community, help educate our communities to do a go and turn out to vote. But there are definitely barriers on our side as well. The number one, of course, is language access. We can move to the next slide. And I think the number one perfect example of this is immigration. You know, I'm an immigration attorney by trade, so obviously I'm speaking very biasedly here. But when a lot of times when I turn on the news,
and I see anything about immigration, it's always framed as a Latino-Hispanic issue. But if you look at the visa bulletins, 3 of the 4 oversubscribed countries here to the United States are all from Asia. China, the Philippines, and Vietnam. I think it's the other one, right? India is the third one. They're all Asian communities. So we ourselves are turning ourselves off to these issues. We're not saying, this is a problem for me. Again, looking back at your home country and saying, you know, whoever the prime minister of my country is matters, and not even looking in your own backyard, I think is a mistake. You know, we should be engaged here in the United States. We live here, we work here, we have our children here. This is where it should matter. So I'm always on the warpath to talk to, especially news reporters, say, it's not just someone else's issue, it's an everyone issue. America needs these problems fixed, and immigration is at the top of the list for me anyway. But again, you know, I think this is something that we're going to have to continually kind of work on. If you look at AAPI data, collection of immigrants here in the United States, again, you know, we always talk about undocumented immigrants being a Latino-Hispanic issue, but this is actually, you know, across the board, we see huge portions of our population who are undocumented here in the United States. And, you know, under this last administration, we had this thing called Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. It gave work permits to hundreds of thousands of young people here in the United States. Not a promise to, you know, become a citizen or become a lawful permanent resident, but gave them the ability to not fear local authority and be able to stay here and work here legally. And I can tell you, from my personal experience, I've had 3 or 4 clients in the last 4 years who are Asian, who sought out that sort of relief. That's not right. You know, this relief is available for you now, and who knows how long it's going to stay around for. It's an executive action. You've gone like that. So, you know, we've had to do a lot of education with our community. It's even here in San Jose, which you kind of would assume everybody knows better, but that's absolutely not the case. Of course, I mentioned earlier a little bit about the language barrier issue. You know, we see it kind of work 2 ways. The first way is, of course, you know, from Asian American voters themselves trying to get information, try to vote. And then the other way from the registered voter side, getting them to cross that bridge, to get people to understand what the issues are, what the ballot's about in that proper language. And of course, there are a bunch of federal data regarding that as well. So as you know, Santa Clara County, where I'm from, is a huge county. And the thing that makes it even more compact with the problem is the fact that we have so many different language groups, like I mentioned. Luckily, we do still have the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which does allow for voter protection under Section 203, which protects, in our county, Vietnamese, Tagalog, Spanish, and Chinese, and that every material that's produced in English is also translated into those other languages. Luckily, our Secretary of State has also created this 3% rule under Section 14201 of the Voting Rights Code, sorry, Elections Code that we have here in California, which also protects Hindi, Korean, Japanese, and Kamal. But those people only get a translated facsimile of the ballot at each of the precincts. And I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to read about that entire ballot on the day of when I'm going in to vote. I don't know how effective that's going to be. So we're continually pushing for more and stronger change in our community to see, you know, more effective methods for getting people to vote. And I think working with the ROV is one way to do it, but, you know, let's face it, they have an agenda to run the elections. They want to see it a certain way. And our job as a community is to make sure that if there are any sort of shortfalls, that we let them know. So this election, Asian Law Alliance is teaming up with a group of 12 other organizations to poll monitor at least 30 precincts in Santa Clara County. It's not many, thank you. But we're going to go out there to look specifically for language access materials. So what we're going to do is we're looking for bilingual ballots, bilingual sample ballots, making sure the voter rights, bill of rights is out there. You know, even checking for simple things like exterior signs. Can you find these places? As you know, most of these precincts around the county are in garages or in people's homes, and finding them can be difficult. So, you know, we're trying to make that as accessible as possible, but, you know, I think there's still a long way to go. We need to continually educate the ROV about, training people about, training people who for people who run into voters who maybe don't speak English as a primary language, you know, who are really enthusiastic to vote and getting them to be able to vote. You know, making sure those provisional ballots are given to people and not turning them away. You know, I was asked to speak a little bit about voter suppression, which we think is not a California issue. But I, well, maybe only I thought that. Apparently, all of you are much more educated. But we see, even in Santa Clara County, where people were being told to wait in different lines. Oh, you're Chinese speaking? You wait in that line over there? I'll help you when I'm done with the English speaking line only. And as you know, that's, you know, I think logistically, I don't think it comes from a bad place. I think poll workers, election officers really do need to help as many people as they can. And, but I think the problem is when we're treating people differently because of the language they speak, we start seeing, basically people being turned off from voting. And that should be the way it is. So we'll be out there trying to make sure that everyone's being treated fairly and that those materials, those bilingual materials, are going to be out for people to see. This is actually a picture of a Cambodian temple I went to with my team just 2 weeks ago, actually. There were 275 people there, and we were there to talk to the Cambodian community about what the ballot's going to look like. You know, they're a small, tight-knit community, but they still raise the level of 3% in our county, and, you know, they're energized. They want to learn more about the ballot. They want to know, you know, what's the best way they can help their community. And I think it would be remiss of us to let that go. So we need to be out there on election day. We need to be out in force to let them know that they are supported by our community and that we want to hear what they have to say. So I kind of end with that, but I think we have time for a few questions,
yeah.
Maybe?
Yeah,
if,
sure.
If there are any.
Questions?
I have one question, actually.
Yeah,
thank you, by the way, your presentation was amazing. This is great because this is, I believe that, and we were talking about during the primary, how much minorities are just kind of excused. It's just, you know, that this is, you know, and there is no excuse for that, actually, because the voting population, in a way, you could win an election or a candidate.
Yeah.
You could.
Absolutely.
So my question is I'm not a big fan of Google because of my politics and the way that with my research with Google. However, they've got this brilliant app called Google Translator, where you just basically take it and you, whatever the signage is, you know how it works, right?
Yeah.
You probably use it. Does it work? Is it effective?
Yeah, that's always been the go-to mechanism for, I think, a lot of folks. And I think, luckily, at least in Santa Clara County, they've learned over the years that's not the best idea. Especially with some languages, because I think Google Translate is much more of a mathematical solution in terms of translation. Dog equals this, cat equals this. But we see, especially in some communities that have trauma in their background in terms of where they're coming from, cultural trauma, that merely translating back and forth like that is a bad idea. A perfect example is that, I believe it was the census back in 2010, they actually translated that into several different languages, one of them was Vietnamese, and they literally, I could be wrong, but I thought they translated something into like supervision or like communism control or something in the census, and everyone saw that and they immediately dropped it. This is the census, we need everyone to fill this out, right? Everyone needs to be counted. And it was one of those things where they probably just put it into a mechanism and just it spit out. So unfortunately, another barrier to this language issue that we have here is you need culturally competent translation. You can't just put it into the machine and hopefully it'll get back up. Santa Clara's done a good job about going out and actually hiring people in the community to do that, but I think we need more of that. We need more discussion of what those materials are actually covering, because, you know, we have even shorter steps to go. I mean, San Jose luckily started using transliteration of candidates' names. I don't know, do you guys know what transliteration is? Maybe, okay, so as you know, if you're from an Asian country, you don't use the Roman lettering. So what they'll do is they'll actually take a candidate's name and then they'll use the Chinese characters to make it sound like the candidate's name so they can actually recognize it. Because if you put that in Roman letters in front of them, they won't know who that is or what that even means. So they ask if they can actually transliterate the names, make it a little more accessible for folks. But again, this is looking at culturally competency, not just putting their name into Google Translate and having to spit back out.
How about the signage? How good is the signage?
So far, the signage has been really good in Santa Clara County anyway. I know we've had issues with that in other places, but the signage, especially because it's so easy to do, right? I mean, to put a welcome sign in several different languages is not hard. Luckily, Santa Clara County has been pretty good about that. You can do languages that aren't covered, but that can also be a little bit misleading because then we're seeing like, oh, I see you have Punjabi out there. and on the bottom side, does that mean you have Punjabi translators here? Oh, you don't? You don't have any of the materials in Punjabi? You know, like, so there's some issues with that, but generally we're seeing, you know, an effort to try to make it accessible to as many humans as possible. Awesome. Great questions, thank you. Sorry, I know it's like the end of the day.
Yeah, one more question in the back.
Disperse those ideas. I think, you know, when we're looking at youth especially, I think we need to remind them that every election is important, and that being depressed about its outcome, unfortunately, is part of the game. And I think not to underplay it, I mean, especially if the reasons for loss are not legitimate, but I do think that if we are going to move forward, we need to still participate. And I think the last thing we need is, oh, it doesn't work, so therefore I'm not going to do it. I gotta tell you, I was registering people on the street and people telling me it's a crooked system, it doesn't work. But, I mean, I tell them, well, if you don't register to vote, you have no say. You know, I try to remind them that there's more to an election than what just happened in the past. There is a lot of things that are happening in the future, and this is the way to effectuate that change.
Right. Go ahead, and then the last one, and then we'll wrap up.
I was a legal observer at Olds, and I saw an incident that you're making me think of. And it was towards the end of the day, and everybody was tired, and there was a woman, I think she probably spoke an Asian language that wasn't as common, and there was an Asian woman that was working there. It was kind of like on the north end of Chinatown near Pope. And so this woman, I guess, kept having problems, and it was probably because the language was issue. And so she was on her third ballot, and the lead worker, I forget the name of the lead worker in the poll, but he yelled at her and said she couldn't have any more ballots, that was it. And so that's the kind of thing that shouldn't be happening. And unfortunately, I didn't really know. I should have put my foot down and told them, but I didn't even know that there was a limit how many ballots a person could have.
Yeah, in Santa Clara County, it's also three as well. And, I think, unfortunately, the only resolution for that a lot of times we see people say, oh, well, then just use the electronic voting machine, as if that's really easy to use. I always try to encourage the people I talk to, remember, they do have a voter hotline, call that voter hotline, call Asian Law Alliance. Call your CBO that you can rely on, because we can make sure that your vote is counted that day. Because after the elections are over, time has passed. So, you know, there are communities out there that are trying to solve those problems. We're going to be out in our communities with people who are bilingual in several different languages, hitting up probably the most AAPI concentrated precincts in our county. We're hoping that will be enough, but, you know, there is, you know, a lot of voter hotlines for a lot of different ROVs around the counties. around the state. So I think, you know, that's probably the best way to do it, unless you do have a CBO who you know and trust, who can make sure that your vote gets counted.
Last question. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to thank you for coming here. I'm actually going to be a poll inspector, and I signed up to be bilingual. I also speak Mandarin Chinese. So
it's great. Yeah,
awesome. The Mandarin Chinese. And the other thing that I wanted to say that I think ties this together, your presentation, with some of the other presentations, is that, like you're saying, it's, you know, if we start to get cynical that the system isn't working, the votes aren't being counted, it can lead to this sense of like, well, then let's just sort of opt out. And I think the work you're doing is really important to increase voter registration and increase voter participation among particular communities. I think for all of us to realize that the fact that Bernie Sanders inspired so many people to vote and the fact that so many people got out and vote is why we know that it was stolen, right? If people, when we have these normal elections where people don't really care, I would say the two candidates that are being thrown at us as a more typical, nobody cares, people may not get out and vote. The reason that we know this, that we can do all of this analysis, is that there were so many votes cast by new and independent voters. So many people wanted to vote. There were a million voters in California that supposedly didn't even cast a vote for president. That looks ridiculous because we know that there were 50,000 people or 20,000 people or 15,000 people in Sacramento to see Bernie Sanders. So we need to continue to participate. We need to continue to do, whether it's civic disobedience, whether it's being a bean counter, whatever you're inspired to do, because most of us are not getting paid to do this. Whatever you're inspired to do, that's your fire inside. That's what will keep you going, and that's what will make change.
All right. Again, privileged to be here. It's really great to be amongst many of you. I've worked for years and a whole bunch of what appear to be Sanders people. I knew Bernie, I met him in 1980, and I've had many of my students have worked for him, but recall that Bernie Sanders is a big fan of my hero, Eugene Victor Debs, right? And what Debs said, and I think Sanders echoes it, of course, is Debs said, look, I would not lead you to the promised land if I could, because if somebody could lead you in, somebody else could lead you out. And I think all of you have found the will to go forward to the promised land, which is really about actual democracy in the United States and the tremendous skill sets in this room. Future historians are going to regard this as the day the people of California decided to perfect democracy in the state. And I think it's a privilege for me to be here. And thank you. Go to GoFundMe.com, take back the vote. Thank you for having me. And again, thanks to Lori for flying me in. It's been a privilege, and Lori Grace.
Seeing the increase of the corporatocracy in the United States, and this is why I was so drawn to Bernie and to his passion and to his consistency in his message. And of course, I was sad along with all of you, you know, when he walked. But what I want to say is, I do think, as soon as I saw what happened in New York, or Arizona, actually, I knew that we were going to be, this was the chance for election integrity to move to the forefront. I've been involved since 2003, and it's just been a group of 40 of us talking, you know? And now we have a bigger audience, and this is the audience we need to make a change. And I wanted to say something. Yes, I've helped fund some things, but I want to tell you something that some of you have been doing, and those of you who are on the info@trustvote.org mailing list, when you give me donations, when you give us donations, I see it as a personal mandate to step forward and continue. If you're giving me money for a lawsuit, I often imagine, but I need your support. I need your caring, I need your ideas, I need your information, and I mean, we do. I should say we, because it's a team, and you know, Bob is on this team as well, and Bill, and you know, actually some of the rest of you, and so I just wanted to encourage you, if you haven't as of yet, to sign up for info@trustvote.org. And we are holding another program tonight in Marin County that I believe prompted for, where we're going to be answering questions. Both, let me address those of you who are on live stream right now, we'll be answering your questions also, as well as people that are, you know, that may come and attend from here as well, or come from directly in our audience. And we'll be covering some other things in more depth, among them the exit poll we took in two Northern California counties, Alameda, Contra Costa, and Santa Clara, that indicated that Bernie won substantially more than was reported at the SOS office. So, you know, just different things, and focusing a little bit more on the electronic part. But I really implore you to come forward. I can't even remotely dream of carrying this, you know, myself, all right? And I need all of you, okay? I mean, we need all of you. Registration begins at 9:30 tomorrow, and it's 10 o'clock start time, and you know, I really want to thank you all for your caring. It's profoundly moving, and I've both internally cried and celebrated in this meeting right now, because it's so deep what we're all embarking upon. Thank you.
Let's chat for a bit. So thank you again. We'll see you on Saturday.